Our next presenter is Dr. J. Olson Franklin. Dr. Franklin is a clinical cardiac electrophysiologist practicing since 1988 with Cardiology Consultants of Texas and Baylor Heart and Vascular Hospital in Dallas. He has won a number of awards, including Texas Super Doctor from Texas Monthly Magazine. He is a researcher with a special interest in Afib catheter ablation and is widely published. Dr. Franklin?
I also want to give my thanks to Melanie for asking us to be involved, and to Rob Cowell, who helped in organizing this, and also to Dr. Risby, whose talk is going to help me because he explained some of the more difficult concepts for me as he talked about catheter ablation. So I'm going to talk about cryoballoon catheter ablation, and it is different from radiofrequency catheter ablation purely based on the energy source that we use. We all cut our teeth using radiofrequency catheters, and we still use radiofrequency catheters for most of the catheter ablation treatment that we utilize for patients with rhythm abnormalities. It's unique with the cryoballoon that we can freeze vessels and create the same sort of scar that we want to create with the radiofrequency catheter, and that's what we'll talk about. So when we look at AFib, I'm gonna do the same sort of thing that Dr. Risby did, and so we may beat you up with this along the way, but our goal is to restore and maintain sinus rhythm, both to hopefully reduce the risk of blood clots and stroke, and more importantly, to alleviate the disabling symptoms of rapid and inefficient heartbeats that occur with AFib. And as you've heard, the options include heart rhythm drugs, surgery, including the maze procedure or variations of that, and the two catheter ablation treatments that we utilize to correct rhythms with invasive procedures, both ablatant pace or AV node modification, or pulmonary vein isolation techniques where we'll use either radiofrequency ablation, which you've heard about, or cryoablation, which I'll explain further. Pacemakers will help prevent slow heart rates, but don't prevent atrial fibrillation. In the old days, we mistakenly thought that a pacemaker would keep patients from having AFib. Oftentimes, they'll facilitate our treatment with other drug therapy. And then cardioversion, which restores rhythm to normal, but requires some other form of treatment to help maintain treatment, because cardioversion only restores the rhythm and doesn't do anything to keep it. The guidelines that we all try to follow in regards to atrial fibrillation come from a group of committees, both from the American College of Cardiology Foundation, the American Heart Association, and the Heart Rhythm Society. The Heart Rhythm Society is what electrophysiologists around the world belong to. It started out as a U.S. organization, but has included people from all around the world, and it's the group of electrophysiologists and provides us our greatest source of information as we take care of patients, especially in regards to what is the standard of care, not only locally, but worldwide in patient care. So within the most recent set of guidelines for AFib, the guidelines suggest that patients that continue to have symptomatic atrial fibrillation should be considered for AFib ablation or pulmonary vein isolation. So if patients are continuing to be symptomatic despite drug therapy, then ablative therapy is reasonable. And especially in young individuals that are very symptomatic, ablation may be preferred over years of drug therapy. If you have any other rhythm abnormality besides AFib, you'll find most electrophysiologists considering catheter ablation as the first treatment option oftentimes, rather than committing you to having to be treated with drug therapy. The current standard now requires, for the most part, that we treat patients with medications first and save ablation till later, except in selected cases. You saw this demonstration about radiofrequency catheter ablation. As you'll see, the little yellow dots that are going around the lasso-shaped catheter in the vein indicates the kind of tedious process that is required to do a radiofrequency ablation. The beating heart makes it difficult to keep our position, how much pressure we put on that around that pulmonary vein varies from location within the left atrium. Both the different pulmonary veins require different maneuvers to get to that area. It's technically challenging and it's slow to perform, and doctors vary in their abilities and success rates with this technique, and so it makes it a little difficult to transfer the results from one doctor to another doctor. And so it's very dependent on how skilled your ablation physician is as to how good a result you may or may not get with radiofrequency catheter ablation. It requires overlapping scars be achieved. The pulmonary vein, as Dr. Risby pointed out, clearly is the key problem. We now recognize that ablation strategies which target the pulmonary veins are the cornerstone for atrial fibrillation ablation, and the majority of AFib ablation procedures target those veins. With the advent of the cryoballoon technique, it has been approved as one of the two options for catheter ablative therapy within the most recent Heart Rhythm Society consensus statement. So this is what it looks like to give you an idea. This is a cartoon that shows the balloon in a pulmonary vein, and it shows that as it freezes, it creates that blue scar. Now, the beauty for me of coming to this kind of meeting is I get to hear how other physicians describe this to patients. I talk to patients about a moat around the pulmonary vein that scar is a moat around the vein that allows these, or that prevents these pulmonary vein potentials from getting into the atrium and causing AFib. I like Dr. Risby's comments about a fence that we erect that blocks conduction into the atrium. But it's, in essence, it's a scar that's created whether you use heating energy with the radiofrequency catheter or freezing energy with the balloon. But we get a scar by freezing that tissue. Requires a big console with some fancy equipment. The catheter you see is attached to that console. It uses liquid nitrous oxide that's delivered from the console into the balloon that's inside the patient's left atrium in their heart. Inside the balloon, it vaporizes and absorbs the heat. And then the vapor is returned back to the console through the tubing that's attached to the console. And the console allows us to move that nitrous oxide safely in and out of the patient's heart via the catheter so that we can freeze to create the scar that we need. This again shows the control mechanism of the balloon, and it's a fairly complicated piece of technology. They come in a couple of sizes. It's not like Walmart. It's not one size fits all. So we have two choices to use, and we've seen improvements in the balloon. We started out with a balloon that was not very flexible, and the latest rendition of it is a much more flexible balloon that allows us to do a better job of one size fits all. The latest addition to this is the use of the Achieve catheter, and we use these lasso-shaped catheters, as you see here, the circular catheter, for mapping those pulmonary veins. And we'll put those lasso-shaped catheters in and out of the vein so that we can see the electrical activity, both to know that it's there before we ablate, and also confirm that we've gotten rid of the potentials to confirm that we've been successful. So basically, we have to work inside the left atrium that requires that we make a puncture from one chamber to the other. In the first image, you see that we've accessed the targeted vein, that we have the lasso catheter in that vein. We inflate the balloon and position it in the opening of the pulmonary vein. We'll then occlude and freeze and ablate that area. And then we'll re-look to see evidence that we've gotten rid of the potentials in the vein. This shows the electrical signals that we see moving away, and they're difficult, but this is what a pulmonary vein potential looks like here. Here's where freezing this potential moves further out time-wise, and then it moves away and is completely gone, so that this electrical signal here now becomes flattened. And this is what it looks like with the balloon inflated in the pulmonary vein with the lasso catheter in the vein. This is a video that shows exactly the same thing, but I think is a very nice way to demonstrate to you what takes place. So here's the catheter going up into the left atrium doing the transseptal catheterization. You see the lightning storm there that is the pulmonary veins firing. This is a little lasso catheter that we position into the opening of the vein to record those electrical signals. Then the balloon is moved over that wire out into the body of the atrium. You can see the lightning storm there again. We want to get rid of that electrical pattern going on there. The balloon is placed into the opening of the vessel. You're looking from the opposite side. And here the balloon is positioned inside the vein. We push pretty firmly against there to get a good seal, and we put dye into the vein to make sure that we have completely occluded the vessel temporarily, so that the dye shows us we have an occlusion, which means that we'll get a nice circumferential fence or scar. And then here demonstrates the, I'm not going to make you see the whole video again, but basically I was going to show the electrical signal going away, but all it was demonstrating was the balloon and the vessel freezing at the time. So the overall conclusions with what we're doing with our current cryoballoon, which is made by Medtronic, and we've had both European trials and a trial called the STOP-AF that showed that cryoballoon therapy effectively treats atrial fib that fails drug therapy. It's a safe procedure. It's a straightforward and very efficient procedure. The treatment success improves with physician training and experience, and it results in shorter procedure times compared to conventional radiofrequency ablation procedures. Why use the cryoballoon? It's faster, a little less risky. It's as good or better than radiofrequency catheter ablation. It's easier for the patient and the physician in most cases, not all. It can be done with one transseptal puncture, meaning that we only have to puncture across the interatrial septum, the divider between the two upper chambers, once. And it doesn't require fancy three-dimensional mapping, which is fairly expensive. What to expect before you get ablated: blood thinner, heart rhythm medications, what Dr. Risby indicated about stopping drug therapy or changing blood thinners depends on the individual physician. Most of us now are comfortable with doing your procedure completely anticoagulated on your blood thinner, depending on what that drug is. Some of us do and some of us don't stop your heart rhythm medicines ahead of time, and that will vary with your doctor, as he pointed out. I do agree that a transesophageal echo is important for most patients prior to the procedure, and we'll usually have done some basic heart testing ahead of time. What do you expect during and after? It's going to be a several-hour procedure, typically a little shorter than radiofrequency catheter ablation in my hands. We also use general anesthesia. Requires an overnight stay, as was indicated. Most every patient goes back on blood thinner for typically 2 months or perhaps as long as 3 months, depending on your need for blood thinner overall. Occasionally, patients will have some atrial fibrillation in the first month to 3 months, and I tell patients that's not a deal breaker. It doesn't mean you had a successful procedure. The scars that we create, however we create them, take a little while for the healing and process to occur to prevent your recurrence. Basic numbers are about a 20% chance of a second procedure, although we're finding in our most recent data that our numbers appear to be much lower than that. And our EP trainee, who's learning to do what we do, has sent an abstract that shows a much lower number of redo rates in our cryoballoon patients. But about a 70% chance of long-term prevention of AFib with this as a single procedure, much as was explained. Complications are the same in general, although the phrenic nerve, the nerve that controls the diaphragm, affects your breathing, that phrenic nerve has a little greater tendency to be affected. Pulmonary vein stenosis or narrowing can occur. Esophageal injury is less common. Patients are up in ambulatory, back on their blood thinners, and go home the following day, returning to work in a day to 7 days post-procedure. Why not have a cryoballoon? If you have persistent AFib and you know you're going to need a lot of radiofrequency energy delivery, then we're not going to necessarily use the cryoballoon. Patients that need a lot more work that we know ahead of time, we'll use radiofrequency energy as our primary source because it's less expensive. If you've had a previous cryoballoon ablation in general, it doesn't make sense to do a second one. Thank you.